Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Can I welcome you all to today's meeting of the Public Petitions Committee? And as always, can I ask you all to switch off any electronic equipment because it does interfere with our sound systems. Apologies have been received from Jackson Carlow. Could I welcome Kenny MacAskill to the committee? Really pleased we've got Kenny as a committee member with his great experience in government. It's been a really big help to our committee in its future deliberations. And could I also thank Chick Brody, who was Deputy Convener. Particularly, I'd like to thank Chick for all the work he carried out, particularly last year during my absence from the committee. And many thanks to Mr. Brody for his commitment to this committee. Before moving to agenda item one, I wish to take the opportunity to place on record a correction to a comment I made at the last but one meeting. During the discussion at the committee meeting on the 11th of November on the petition about local authority non-residential social care charges, I said that Falkirk Council was one of the higher charging authorities. I'm happy to correct that and to confirm that Falkirk is not one of the higher charging authorities. Agenda item one, declaration of interests. The first item on the agenda is the declaration of interest from Ken MacAskill. In accordance with Schedule 3 of the Code of Conduct, can I invite Mr. MacAskill to declare any interests relevant to the remit of the committee? Any declaration should be brief but sufficiently detailed to make clear to the listener the nature of the interest. Thank you. Agenda item two is choice of deputy convener. The next item of business is selection of deputy convener. Members have a note from the clerk setting out the procedure for selecting a deputy convener. The Parliament has agreed that members of the SNP are eligible to be chosen as a deputy convener for the Public Petitions Committee. This being the case, can I invite nominations for the position of deputy convener?
Convener, I'd like to nominate David Turns.
Thank you for that. Is there any further nominations? One nomination has been received, and I therefore ask the committee to agree that David Torrens, MSP, be chosen as Deputy Convener of the Public Petitions Committee. Are we agreed? Thank you, and welcome Mr. Torrens to your position. Agenda item three is consideration of a current petition. The next item business is an evidence session with the Scottish Government as part of the committee's consideration of petition PE 1458 by Peter Cherbi on a register of interest for members of Scotland's judiciary. Members have a note by the clerk and the submissions. I'd also like to mention that though nothing has been received from the Judicial Complaints Reviewer, the petitioner notified the clerk that JCR's annual report to 31st of August, which covers the tenure of the previous office holder, Mo Ali, was published on Friday, so some members may already have received that. Could I welcome Paul Wheelhouse, who's the Member for Community Safety and Legal Affairs, and his officials, who's Kate McCorquodale, and Catherine Hodgson from the Scottish Government Civil Law and Legal Systems Division. You're very welcome. Thank you very much for coming along. And could I invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement, approximately 5 minutes, after which we'll move to questions. Mr. Wheelhouse.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for inviting me today. I welcome this further consideration of the issues around a register of interests for the judiciary, in particular the sufficiency of the existing safeguards. The Scottish Government takes the view that it's not necessary to establish a formal register of judicial interests. That is because, as my predecessor, Rosanna Cunningham, has stated, the Scottish Government considers that the safeguards that are currently in place are sufficient to ensure the impartiality of the judiciary in Scotland. There's no evidence to date that safeguards have failed. In short, the important safeguards are the judicial oath taken by all judicial office holders before they sit on the bench, which requires judges to do right to all manner of people without fear or favour, affection or ill will. The statement of principles of judicial ethics, which states at principle 5 that all judicial office holders have a general duty to act impartially. In particular, it notes, plainly it is not acceptable for a judge to adjudicate upon any matter in which he or she or any members of his or her family has a pecuniary interest. The third thing is the Judiciary and Courts Scotland Act 2008, which contains provisions to regulate and investigate the conduct of judicial office holders. Under Section 28, the Lord President has a power to make rules for the investigation of, and I quote, any matter concerning the conduct of judicial office holders, unquote. The complaints about the Judiciary Scotland rules came into force in 2011 and were updated in 2013. The Lord President also consulted on the adequacy of the rules in autumn 2013. The formal Judicial Complaints Reviewer contributed to this consultation, and I understand that the new rules, together with accompanying guidance, will be published early in 2015. The new rules will simplify the complaints process for all concerned and clarify what can be properly investigated. In addition, as you're aware, from 1st of April 2014, the Scottish Court Service has set up a public register of judicial recusals. This register was set up following the former JCR's call for a greater transparency and accountability and the informal meeting between yourself, Convener, the Deputy Convener, Chick Brodie, at the time, and Lord President. This register sets out the reason why a member of the judiciary has recused him or herself from hearing a case, and this is a welcome addition to the safeguards I've already mentioned. With regard to the complaint system, I'm aware of the criticisms made in the former JCR's annual report published last week. I would like to acknowledge the positive influence that the former JCR has had in relation to the handling of complaints about judicial conduct during her time in office, and this has contributed to the improvements that are being made to the complaint system. It is, of course, of vital importance that judges are seen to be both independent and impartial. They must be free from prejudice by association or relationship with a party to a litigation. They must be able to demonstrate impartiality by having no vested interest, such as a pecuniary interest or indeed a familial interest that could affect them in exercising their judicial functions. Setting up a register of judicial interests would be a matter for the Lord President as head of the judiciary in Scotland. The Lord President takes the view that a register of pecuniary interest for the judiciary is not needed and that a judge has a greater duty of disclosure than a register of financial interests itself could address. The Statement of Principles of Judicial Ethics states that a judge's disclosure duties extend to material relationships, and the new register of recusals addresses this issue. It's also important to bear in mind the potential downsides of establishing a register of judicial interests. The Lord President said in his written evidence to the committee that it's possible that, and I quote, information held in a register of judicial interests could be abused. If publicly criticised or attacked, a judicial office holder cannot publicly defend himself or herself, unlike a politician. The establishment of such a register therefore may have the unintended consequences of eroding public confidence in the judiciary, unquote. The Lord President has provided further information about the new register of recusals in his letter to the committee of 21st of November, and this records that all but two judicial recusals were on a voluntary basis. There is no record of a case where a judge or sheriff who has an interest that would justify recusal has had to recuse him or herself when a party raised the matter. There is therefore no evidence to demonstrate that the existing system of recusals is not working. I would like to acknowledge the work, Convener, that the committee has done in taking forward the issues raised by this petition. As the Convener as acknowledged in the Chamber debate, the New Zealand Bill was ultimately withdrawn on the basis that agreement was reached to improve the rules on recusals and conflicts of interest. We have similarly had the opportunity for open discussion of these issues, and improvements have already been made in Scotland, such as the introduction of the public register of judicial recusals that I referred to earlier. Improvements to the complaints rules are about to be introduced, and the Scottish Government's position is that a formal register of judicial interest is not practical nor necessary, and I'm now happy to take questions, Convener.
Thank you, Minister. Why should the judiciary be treated any differently from other holders of public office, such as ministers, MSPs or MPs?
Well, I think the point, Convener, I just referred to in my opening remarks that was made by the Lord President himself in his letter of the 21st of November, I think is pertinent here. I certainly recognise that as politicians we have a duty to be accountable to the public that elect us and to be able to demonstrate that we do not have any conflict of interest. The position of the judiciary is somewhat different. As the Lord President has outlined, they don't have the ability to answer for themselves if they are criticised or attacked for their interests, and therefore they are vulnerable in that sense. There's also the concern that in some respects, particularly if there was any register of property details or issues which might cause security concerns for individuals or their families, and that potentially opened them up to threats of intimidation. I just put it in the context of my previous role, where I was aware of SEPA officials who were being stalked, harassed on social media. Their families were being stalked and harassed on social media, and they were being physically and verbally threatened on a regular basis in dealing with some serious individuals involved with organised crime, it has been alleged. So therefore, you know, I've seen it in a previous context that officials can be intimidated or tempted to be intimidated by those who have ill intent. And so therefore, the more that we protect the privacy of aspects which could give security concerns to the judiciary, that will be better in terms of ensuring that we have no attempt to in any way influence the decision of a judge.
How do you respond to the arguments from the petitioner and the previous JCR that the current system does not provide individuals with sufficient protection from judicial bias?
I'm aware that of the concerns. I mean, I want to recognise the genuine concerns that have been raised by members of the public, including Mr. Cherbi and indeed committee members during the debate on the 9th of October, and the concern to ensure that anyone is particularly pointed the finger of blame at any particular judge, I stress, but that there is at least a perception that the judicial system in Scotland is above reproach and there is no danger of bias in terms of the decision-making process. Clearly the concern that has been expressed has been addressed in a number of respects. We have the JCR position and the ability to lodge a complaint against the judiciary if it comes to light that there has been any conflict of interest which has not been disclosed, and therefore say there's a mechanism by which people can raise a complaint and that can be taken forward by the JCR. Also, the recusals process itself, where to date, we have, as I said in my opening remarks, no evidence to suggest that someone has been forced to recuse themselves by someone raising a conflict or interest. In every case so far, the judge concerned has brought forward their own issues and therefore recused themselves, or has, in the case of two cases that I'm aware of, notably the most latterly, Judge Cowan, who brought forward the issue that being a member of the RSPB might be perceived as a conflict, and put that to both parties in the court case, and they were given the option as to whether to allow her to continue in her role or whether she should recuse herself, and ultimately the defendant in that case asked for her to recuse herself. So that the process does seem to work, and therefore we have no evidence to suggest that, to date at least, that there is any such bias that has been identified in any court case.
But how will the parties know there's a conflict if it's not register of interest? They're not psychic.
I take the point, and I'm aware that clearly these are concerns that I will take forward when I meet for the first time. I've not yet met Lord Gill, or indeed the new JCR, Gillian Thompson, OBE. I will raise these issues when I meet with them in the context of wider discussions and see if they have any thoughts themselves. But I think the principle here is about the register. If there was a public register, and I note again for the record that New Zealand, which was the original prompt for this case coming forward before the Scottish Parliament, has decided itself to drop the proposal for a public register and to strengthen its recusal process and its complaints procedure, which are two systems which are already in place in Scotland, and in the case of the complaints procedure is currently being updated by the Lord President, that these systems are being deployed in New Zealand as well, rather than a public register. There are concerns about the ability to ensure that there is no undue influence or harassment of figures within the judiciary as a result of information they present. And in any case, the register could never be completely complete, if I can mix in my terms there very badly, in that it's very difficult for a judge to anticipate the full extent of cases that might come before them, and therefore they could potentially have to declare absolutely everything in terms of every person they know, every organisation they're a member of, every financial interest they have, and that may be entirely unnecessary given the caseload that comes before them.
Arguments is true for ministers. You're not expected to declare every single aspect. There is a laid-down procedure for what you as an individual minister and I as an individual member has to lay down. No one's asking us to be psychic. We need to make sure we follow the rules that are laid down. If it's good enough for us, why is it not good enough for judges?
Well, I think, if I may, I take the point entirely, Convener, and I think it's entirely appropriate that we do declare that information as ministers and MSPs and MPs, indeed. We have the opportunity, albeit sometimes it doesn't feel that way in terms of the media, to be able to answer for our actions and to be able to get our point across in a way that a judge may not be able to do so. Politicians can answer for ourselves. We are usually pretty robust in when we do so. It is more difficult for a member of the judiciary, and I think we have to recognise that as a parliament. They are in a different position and unable to answer for themselves in the way that we would.
I must say, I haven't noticed that judges are slow to come forward in the Sunday Mail recently, but that's our leader. Can start with David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. In the letter submitted to the committee on the 21st of November by the Lord President, the Judiciary Scotland rules, there's new guidance and rules going to be published early in 2015. Does the Minister think they will go some way to addressing the concerns raised by the petitioner?
It's a very, very good point, Deputy Convener. We have, and congratulations, by the way, on your election, Deputy Convener. We clearly will have to leave the detail of this to Lord President to bring forward his response to the issues that have been raised by the JCR in the past and also in the most recent report. And obviously, these are issues that I will look to discuss with the Lord President when I do meet Lord Gill in due course. But in terms of the detail that is in there, I will shortly bring in Kay McCorquodale, if I may, and just to discuss what detail we're aware of. But I have every confidence the Lord President has listened to the criticisms. There's already been some moves that have been made to try and address some of the concerns that were raised both by the committee and importantly, the JCR, the former JCR, Moy Ali, in terms of her concerns about complaints procedure, and clearly reflecting on the report, which raises some concerns about specific cases, to make sure that the complaints procedure addresses all those. I will be looking to, as the Minister, to see that that those procedural weaknesses that have been identified have been addressed in due course. But if I can maybe bring in Kay McCorquodale, Convener, with your permission.
I must say the Scottish Government is in exactly the same position as the Minister here in that we've not seen the draft rules. We know there's been a consultation and we know that the Judicial Complaints Review are fed into that consultation, and we've every anticipation that her concerns will have been addressed. But we will meet with the Lord President's private office, and I'm sure they will let us see the rules when they're in a position to share them with us.
Thank you. John Wilson.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. May I welcome you to your new role as the Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs. Minister, you've indicated and laid out quite clearly your defence for not having a register. The petition that's before this committee is one that called for a register to ensure that the public could have confidence in the judiciary in Scotland. There was an article earlier this year in The Guardian, which highlighted problems that were being identified in England and Wales about who judges the judges. So the question I would like to ask you, Minister, is, are you 100% confident that every judge and every sheriff will recuse themselves when there is an interest that they may have in the issue before them when they're in the bench? Because one of the problems we have is, and one of the issues raised by the petitioner, is that they feel that we don't have on public record information to tell us whether or not a sheriff or a judge has an interest on the issue before them, or even the individuals before them, that it may be come out at a later date and it may be seen as unfair by the person who is appearing in court, that they feel they've been unfairly treated and unfairly judged in those circumstances?
Well, there are clearly some very, very significant issues there that have been raised by John Wilson. First of all, thank you for your welcome, Mr. Wilson. And in terms of the, can I give 100% guarantee that every judge will always recuse themselves appropriately, I think it would be unreasonable for me to say that I can, in the sense that, you know, I can't be 100% certain every MSP or every MP or every other public person, celebrity, whoever, will always declare their interests. But am I confident that the system in place has procedures there to address that, or will do in the course of the reforms to the complaints procedure? I believe so. It's worth stating that, you know, there's a potential that to pick up the point about the confidence, the public confidence in the judiciary is extremely important. I think that's Mr. Wilson has hit the nail on the head there in terms of the rationale behind the whole debate that we are having is to deliver confidence in the judiciary and ensure that is maintained. We were trying to search as to whether any surveys that defined this one way or the other, and we haven't been able to pick up a survey to date, Convener. But you know, there are certainly, from a personal perspective, I don't have any sense that there is a widespread concern about the judiciary and a lack of confidence in the judiciary. There may be, from time to time, disagreements over the outcome of particular cases, and that's entirely understandable where you have two parties to a dispute, both a defendant and a prosecutor. But there is not the impression I have that there is a widespread concern about the judiciary. So how do we make sure that that is maintained and there is never a concern about the ability of the judiciary to be unbiased? And we need to have in place robust systems for recusals, which I think we are developing, and it seems to be the case that to my mind at least, that the judiciary are using the recusal process appropriately. We have a complaints procedure that is perfect, apparently not, and I recognise the points that have been made by the GCR in her report. I'm confident the Lord President will reflect on those and reform the process. Are there sanctions for those who fail to recuse themselves? Yes, there are. And if judicial holders, office holders, do breach those rules and find that a complaint is made, potentially it might be grounds for an appeal if it's an original case that people feel that the judge should not have taken that case. That could be a legitimate grounds for appeal, and obviously that will depend on a case-for-case basis. But the Lord President may give the judicial office holder formal advice about what they've done, or obviously a formal warning or indeed a reprimand, which would be damaging to their reputation. So there are measures in place to address the situation should they arise. But I do recognise the concern about the fact that the recusal process, if you like, is to some extent shrouded in privacy because it is within the judiciary itself and not open to public scrutiny. And as I say, I will look to discuss the degree to which the Lord President and the new JCR, Gillian Thompson, have any suggestions as to how that might be addressed in future.
Thank you, Minister. But you are aware that recusals are voluntary, and while I welcome the Lord President's submission in relation to the number of recusals, and you mentioned yourself Judge Cowan's decision to recuse herself in a case that she was hearing in terms of wildlife issues, the issue is that it's still voluntary. And how a member of the public or someone appearing before the bench is aware that a judge or a sheriff may have a particular interest in the issue they're hearing may come out after the case and are beyond the appeal process time, because the appeal process time is very limited in terms of, it's a 3-month appeal process as I understand it. So it may be a matter of 12 months, 2 years down the road that it may come out that a judge or a sheriff had a particular vested interest in a case that they were hearing. So how does that provide confidence in the judiciary system that we have in Scotland if people feel that judges, and you said it yourself, shrouded in secrecy in terms of how the complaints process is dealt with? So how do we ensure the public have more confidence that when they are appearing in court, they will be dealt with without fear or favour in relation to the case that's being heard before a sheriff or a judge?
Well, I certainly note the points that Mr. Wilson has made. Just to identify that there are three possible scenarios in terms of recusal. The two that have been used so far are where someone voluntarily recuses themselves. So they identify themselves as a risk, and they decide for themselves that it's such a significant issue that they voluntarily recuse themselves from taking forward that case. Second scenario is where there's an element of perception about it, perhaps that they don't believe it's going to materially impact on their decision, but they offer that to the both sides in the court case and leave it to them to decide whether they feel the member of the judiciary should recuse himself, and that's happened twice to my knowledge. And so therefore that has worked. The third scenario would be potentially where a judge or sheriff who has an interest that would justify recusal says nothing about it and thereafter has to recuse himself or herself when a party raises the matter. And I appreciate this is during the court case. We have no record of any instance of this happening so far. So from the point of view of, and I've no information provided me to this date, convener, that there has been a conflict of interest that has not been identified during the court case and has only been revealed thereafter. Now, I appreciate the recusal process is relatively new, so we can't guarantee it's never happened in the past, but the recusal process now that it's up and running, and perhaps we've not put enough emphasis on it as well, the oath as well that the judiciary have to take is quite onerous and is quite clear and in terms of the requirements of the judiciary in terms of to assess their potential conflicts of interest and under sort of ethical guidance. Sure.
Question. I mean, the big issue I've been pushing, I think my colleagues have as well, is that you're assuming that those appearing before a judge have got some form of psychic powers here. How are they going to know that there's a conflict? If there's not a register, they're not going to be aware of this. Until Trick Brodie and myself met the Lord President, and I'll be fair to the Lord President here, there wasn't a system of recording recusals. That was a point we made to the Lord President, and in fairness, he agreed to that. That only came into force in April. So it's only since then that you've been able to assess whether judges have recused or not. Before that, it was a complete mystery. Even recusals were a mystery. Mm-hmm. So the point I'm making to you is you're making out that this is very much, you know, everything's done in fairness and it's all above board. I mean, the ordinary person appearing before a judge will not have a clue whether there's any conflict in the judge appearing before him. And that's the key point. We are wanting, or the petitioner is wanting, a system that's similar to what other public officials have. And the only real argument you've got is that the judges can't defend themselves. Well, I'm sorry, I don't think that's a very strong argument, frankly.
If I can say so, Convener, that's a misrepresentation of what I said earlier on. I did not say that's the only grounds. I think there are serious concerns about potential influence on the judiciary of revealing their interests in a public register. It would open them up to potentially hostile and aggressive press action, which might themselves apply pressure on them to come down a particular way in terms of their adjudication. And it may, in some cases, as I said earlier on, if revealing property interests or of anything, it might give away an address, a physical address. It could put them physically at risk of threats, in relation to I have experienced in terms of colleagues I worked with within the Scottish Environmental Protection Agency who have been threatened by those who are involved in criminal activity. So I think we have to be very careful what we wish for here. I totally take on board your points, Convener, about the need for transparency in the sense that people have to understand that that the judicial system is fair, above board and unbiased, and that is entirely right that the committee has taken a very strong interest in that. I'm merely appealing to the committee to think about the potential consequences of having a public-facing register that could expose members of the judiciary to undue influence from outside the court process and put them at risk or their families at risk in doing so. We have to recognise that many members of the judiciary are dealing with extremely sensitive and some often extremely violent people in the context of their work, and it is different from politicians. It is important they don't have the right to defend themselves, and I raise that point. That's a fair point for the convener to have raised, but I do have a concern more widely about the risk it puts to the judiciary too.
Sorry, I'm a bit conscious of time. I want to bring Kenny McCaskill and I want to come back to John Wilson, but just before we leave that point, nobody in this committee wants to put judges at any security concerns. Ministers and MSPs don't reveal their home addresses. We would obviously have a basic procedure that follows that. So also, we'd not want you to misrepresent what I'm suggesting. We would obviously have a registrar that would respect the security concerns of judges. To do otherwise would be very strange policy indeed. Ken McCaskill and then John Wilson.
Public interest. The jurisdiction that does have a register is the United States. I have to say, I'm only going by apocryphal tales, but I've seen potential candidates for the Supreme Court, frankly, probably dissuaded, if not rejected, by House committees where they have been, frankly, pilloried. It's where the balance is struck. And I just wondered if there was any jurisprudential evidence from the United States as to whether it has been enhanced or whether the public opprobrium wreaked upon many people who were potential nominees for the Supreme Court just dissuaded people from going into that theatre at all.
Well, that's an important point that Mr. McCaskill raises. In his submission 23rd of October, the petitioner drew attention to the position in relation to Register of Interest in America. And we have, you know, the origins of the US, the United States itself as a country explains to some degree the formal regulation of government ethics. There has been sort of a great attention on this since the Watergate scandal in the 1970s, and the Ethics in Government Act in 1978 was brought in to require federal judges to file annual financial reports and have a full financial disclosure committee. So the purpose is to expose judges' financial holdings. to public scrutiny, which assists the judges in avoiding conflicts of interest. So there is a system in place in the United States. I know I've seen some of the reporting in terms of particular judges. I won't quote it here for the record, but just in terms of the kind of details that are posted. Largely, you know, it includes things like retirement accounts and life insurance policies, and I'm not sure if that really adds any value, but it does potentially open up people to being pilloried in the way that Mr. McCaskill says, and having every detail of their financial activities poured over in enormous detail. But you know, when people are investing in a general insurance policy or a pension fund, they don't have any day-to-day involvement in the decisions that are being taken about who that is invested. I'm not sure what relevance it adds to the process. I think there has been one case in Scotland in regards to a pecuniary interest, but in that case it was clear that the decision wouldn't have influenced the shareholder value, and therefore it wasn't likely to have had any influence in terms of the pecuniary interest of the judge, him or herself. But I don't know whether colleagues, either Kay or indeed Catherine, have any information about of the kind that Mr. McCaskill has asked for in terms of negative consequences in the United States.
I don't have any evidence to hand of that. And I think the interesting thing is, as well, that register only deals with financial holdings in the manner which Mr. Wheelhouse has just explained. So there's no personal interest or anything else. It's very narrow, and it is only federal judges. It doesn't go any wider.
Anne McTaggart.
Thanks, Convener. And welcome, panel, and welcome the Minister to his new role. Minister, could I... There has been some discussion this morning about the differences, but can I ask you to expand on the differences between, say, perhaps our own role and your role as a minister? Why you think that would be different, that we have to declare and judges don't? I'm not fully aware. I'm not fully convinced yet that there is an argument there.
I certainly recognise it. Indeed, I suppose to fairly reflect the convener's point as well. I mean, I don't think I don't want to misrepresent the convener in terms of his approach. I'm sure he's entirely above board his intent here, and didn't wish to present anything other than that. But I suppose the concern we have is here two fronts, really. One is that we as MSPs, we disclose our pecuniary interests and any other things we perceive might be a conflict of interest. There's a lot of trust in us to declare those issues we believe might influence our decision-making as MSPs, our roles, whether they're ministers or committee members or indeed backbenchers and more generally. And we are trusted to do so, and I believe we have a good record as a parliament in doing this. There's any degree of criticism of what's in our registers of interest, we have the ability to defend ourselves, and we have the right to do so, and we have the forum to do so as well in Parliament, where we can correct that and put things right on the public record. It is more difficult, I believe. I'm not a member of the judiciary. I have no axe to grind in this particular fight, other than I think that there's an issue of fairness here, and they don't have the same ability to defend themselves in public in the way that we do. That's not to say that there isn't an interest in making sure that everything is above board, and I recognise the points that have been made by the committee. Indeed, as I've alluded to, I will be looking to get feedback from the new JCR, Gillian Thompson, and indeed Lord President himself, whenever I have the chance to meet him, as to what they both think is necessary to try and give confidence, the public confidence, that albeit the system that's largely hidden from view is operating in a robust way, and that those who are... perceived to have a conflict of interest in a case are raising that, are recusing themselves voluntarily, or at least making sure that both parties to a case are aware that there is a risk of a conflict of interest and giving them that choice. I think it's very, very important it's seen to be properly applied and robustly applied, and that there is no subsequent criticism of the kind that Mr. Wilson fairly raised, that potentially someone could have a conflict of interest that they were totally unaware of in terms of the judge who oversaw their case, and it may be too late in terms of the appeals process to do anything about it. And we need to get feedback from the Lord President himself and indeed the new JCR as to how they perceive that should be dealt with.
Thank you. McDonald.
Okay, thanks. Congratulations again on your new appointment and portfolio, Minister. You've perhaps touched on this briefly, but could you perhaps expand on your argument or the Scottish Government's argument that The information on a register could be misleading, as it wouldn't cover all of the potential conflicts that could arise. And do you have a view on the argument that even if a register is incomplete, it could still have value in increasing transparency?
Well, I think obviously we have to pick up as well, just a parallel to Anne McTaggart's point as well, that you know, in the course of a debate, for example, if we believe we've not got something on our or we've got something on our register of interest we want to draw people's attention to, we can do that at the beginning of a debate speech. We can say, you know, presiding officer, bring to your attention my register of interest, and we can flag up that there's a particular concern to make members aware. So we've got the ability to do that on a case-by-case basis. If we're talking about a register that people have to write in advance, it would be potentially quite difficult to define exactly, you know, if you're dealing with general cases and not a specialist in a judicial sense, it would be quite difficult to think, you know, every scenario that you could cover, every scenario where there potentially could be a conflict of interest, every potential plaintiff, every potential defendant in a court case that might come forward, and every single interest to declare. So it would have to be entirely comprehensive or targeted. And I think there's a potential that if people haven't at that point anticipated that a case might come forward and they don't put it on the register of interest, it could be misleading. And people might think, oh, there's no conflict of interest there. But actually, subsequently, they have to add something in advance of a case to make sure that that's clear. So I'm not entirely sure that it would be easy to operate such a publicly facing register and make sure it was fully encompassing of all the potential conflicts of interest that any particular judge or sheriff could find themselves in. But more generally, it's you know, we've got the example in the US, which is, as Kay McCorquodale has said, is only really covering the financial aspects. It's not covering their personal relationships or memberships of bodies, which may be an issue. And so it would have to probably be wider than the one in the US to cover all of these potential issues. And it then comes a very difficult thing to manage in terms of, you know, at what point do you decide you know someone sufficiently well enough to put them on a register of interest? You've met someone on the bus. Does that mean you've got to declare an interest that you've had a friendly conversation with them? Or, you know, or is it somebody you've been a lifelong friend? So it's quite a difficult thing to define, and I certainly you know, welcome committee's view on it, but I don't see the cases compelling at this point myself.
Thanks, Minister. I find it strange that in the American situation, that where it is a requirement to register a financial interest, that they don't have to register membership of bodies. That's information that I wasn't aware of.
Well, that appears to be the case. I look to colleagues just to check that. It appears to be the case, Mr. McDonald, that there's no requirement to register memberships, and that, I do find that slightly odd if the intent is to try and to capture all the potential conflicts. And that seems odd. But in response to that, we have examples in Scotland where people have recused themselves for being members of organisations. So we're one step ahead of the US in that sense. Obviously, Sheriff Cowan recently withdrew from a case voluntarily after having raised the issue with both parties to the case. There was obviously a risk, having been a member of the RSPB, and there were witnesses coming forward who were from the RSPB, that might be perceived to be a conflict of interest rather than an actual conflict of interest. And she gave them the option, and they asked her to recuse herself. And so the system worked well in that case. So we have a system that does appear to work. I appreciate the concerns that we have to be sure it works every time, because, you know, one case going through that doesn't work, then that's obviously a concern. But we have no evidence to date that has happened. So let's look at the glass being half full at this stage.
Thanks. John Wilson, because I think I cut him off. Last question.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener. And very interesting debate in relation to the constitutional issue of the United States of America and appointment of Supreme Court judges, and I'm sure the Judicial Appointments Board in Scotland will look very carefully at how judges are appointed to the Supreme Court and try and draw in the rules there. But to concentrate on the Register of Interest, Minister, you gave an example in your opening statement that through your experience in your previous ministerial role, that you were aware that senior officials of SEPA were being stalked and harassed by certain elements within the community. I find it really strange in your new role as the Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs, will you be intending to bring forward new legislation which protects public office holders from being harassed and stalked and approached by criminal people involved in criminal activity to secure the safety of the not only the office holders but their families. Because if part of the reason for not having a register is that judges and sheriffs may find themselves being stalked and harassed by certain elements in society, then surely we have to look at the legislation that protects individuals against that type of behaviour.
Well, if I can, Convener, I can give Mr Wilson the assurance that in my previous role we actually brought that forward in the Regulatory Reform Act to protect CEPA officials. That was the reason why those particular measures in that particular act were brought in, protection for CEPA officers, bringing them into line with other key emergency workers in terms of protection. But I take the wider point about the judiciary. Clearly it would be a criminal offence to do what we're describing. There's a great argument, I think, for prevention rather than a cure. I mean, why create a situation where we're having to create a new protection for judges rather than put them in the position in the first place? If we can avoid giving away sensitive information that might lead them to be coerced in any way, then that's better than having to resolve the situation subsequently through either new legislation or applying existing legislation to do so. I do take the point that Mr Wilson is very fairly making, that you know, the government has a duty to protect people in this situation, and I can assure Mr Wilson that I will do everything in my power to help protect members of the judiciary from being threatened in that way. But I think it's better to prevent rather than have to resolve. But if I can maybe ask Kay McCorquodale if she can give some guidance on what protection there is.
I think that's exactly what the Minister has said. It's a very serious consideration that we'll take into account. I just want to go back to the situation with the UK Supreme Court, which was mentioned, and in the context of judicial appointments. Actually, the situation in the UK Supreme Court is that when it was set up, it was decided that it would not be appropriate or indeed feasible for them to have a comprehensive register of interests, because it would be impossible for them to identify all the interests which might conceivably arise. So instead, they have a formal code of conduct, and which is similar to the position that we have in Scotland with the Statement of Judicial Ethics. I just wanted to state that for the record.
I'd like to come back on that point, but I'm not going to cut John Wilson off again. So, Mr Wilson.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, you actually said you'd be wary about having sensitive information put on the public record. Could you define sensitive information? Would that be financial information, family relationship information? Because we could potentially have a judge or a sheriff hearing a court case where their son or daughter or their mother or father or an aunt or uncle may actually be appearing before them and defending someone in a case or representing someone in a case. So what could you define for us today what you mean by sensitive information appearing on a register?
Well, I can give some examples, Convener. I think I would need to get guidance as from justice professionals, the police, as to what might constitute information that could potentially risky in terms of modern technology and the ability to attack or damage the interests of individuals. But certainly information, say, on property, if it was, I think the Convener made a very fair point that potentially, personal households might be kept off any such register. I think that would be a sensible thing to do if there ever did reach a position where there was a register. And that's an appropriate thing to do in that circumstance, to protect the safety of the individual and their family, and that they can have their residence kept private and therefore not be perhaps a honeypot for those who might want to coerce them in advance of a decision. Anything else, I guess, that threatens the safety or indeed potentially opens them up to coercion in terms of the court case itself, because obviously we want to protect the integrity of the decision-making process in the court as well as the safety of those actually making the decisions. But just see if there's anything else in terms of examples. Yeah, so Kay McCorkey also pointed out that the assets, income and liabilities of judges, spouses and dependent children must all be disclosed, although information may be redacted to protect an individual's safety if it's endangered. This is a situation in the US. So they've obviously had a look at this issue, and that's maybe something worth the committee having an examination of.
Obviously, it seems to me that it's for those who would wish a register to potentially define it. And I'm minded from what John Wilson was saying, that there was a recent case in which a judge made a declaration in a high-profile case relating to a football club that he was a season ticket holder at another football club. It'd be fair to say, would it be your understanding that that wouldn't have been a financial interest? It wouldn't have been an interest that he would require to give. He didn't recuse himself, but he did publicly make it available. That seemed to me to be the right thing to do, but I just wondered if you had any comments on that generality as to what you would register, because it did seem to me that the judge was correct to make that declaration, and perhaps it's best left to conflict of interest rather than to price rules, because clearly, are we expecting a judge to define or declare if he's a season ticket holder at a football club or a rugby club and a declaration of interest?
I think we have to be, I think Mr McCaskill's absolutely right, we have to be reasonable about this. It's left to MSPs, for example, to judge themselves as to what they believe might constitute or be perceived to constitute a conflict of interest, and therefore to declare things, and voluntarily, if need be, there's a section on the MSP register where we can voluntarily declare things we might, you know, go above and beyond, if you like, what the minimum requirements are. And I'm sure most people, if not all of us, use that facility. And I think, you know, we have to rely on the oath, the kind of guidelines which are in place to guide members of the judiciary to consider what things that might be perceived as a conflict of interest or an actual conflict of interest, and to declare those and leave that to them as to judge themselves as to what they feel is appropriate to declare. And I entirely commend the point that Mr. McCaskill's made, that somebody voluntarily made that point, where just so that there could be no perception that there was a conflict of interest, even though that wasn't strictly speaking required under the terms of the recusals policy. Obviously, we have examples of members of the judiciary behaving entirely appropriately and recusing themselves or giving the information to allow others to decide whether they should recuse themselves, and I think we should commend that. And I entirely recognise the role of the committee in driving forward, making that a publicly facing register now of recusals, which I think is a very welcome addition to the process, and I commend the committee for achieving that. And I think that will help further drive it, so people can see the kind of examples, and that will inform those involved with future court actions as to what kind of things do constitute a conflict of interest and help refine the process further.
To go back to Kay McCorquodale's point about the Supreme Court, you will be well aware, Minister, that prior to the setting up of the Supreme Court, that the Scottish Law Lords were members of the House of Lords and had to comply with the Registrar of Interests of the House of Lords. And I'm not suggesting... You have suggested that in some sense a Registrar of Interests is an alien concept to the Scottish legal system. Well, of course it's not. For generations, law lords were in the House of Lords and filled in the Registrar of Interests. So the idea that sometimes shock horror we're going to have to fill in the Registrar is not in fact shock horror new at all. This went on for generations. Why did it work well then? Why couldn't it work for judges and sheriffs now?
Well, I think that's a fair comment, Convener. Obviously, the law lords did have disclosure under financial interests, and I think perhaps financial, pecuniary interests are areas where perhaps there might be perception, the public could perceive there to be a conflict of interest if there's particularly if there's a damages case, perhaps, and a company is being affected by a damages outcome, and there happened to be the judge happened to have shares in that company, clearly there would be a conflict of interest there. And so I can understand why both in the US and in the case of the position the law lords had in the House of Lords disclosure rules, that financial interests were declared. What I think the petitioner is asking for is something considerably beyond that. Full disclosure of information which might, as I say, in some categories of information might be perceived to put people at risk either of intimidation or intrusive press activity, which would be unhelpful, I think, in maintaining
the petitioner is asking for a register of pecuniary interests.
Okay, well, I mean, there are obviously certain bounds. We've been talked about property assets that you would have to have some safeguards there in relation to personal property, and I recognise that, Convener, you've identified with that already.
Yeah.
There are examples, and I take the point on board, and these are kind of things I would have to take forward to Lord President and the GCR, the new GCR, Gillian Thompson, to get their view on.
I'm conscious of time. I think it was important to continue, and I think thanks, McDonald. Did you have a quick point?
Just covered the point I was going to raise.
I think the general point I'd just like to say for the record is that I do think, first of all, we have a very high level in terms of quality of the judiciary, and by European and indeed international standards, we are remarkably free of corruption. So I wouldn't want to get any other view than that. However, I do think it's important that for ordinary men and women appearing before judges, that there is an element of transparency, and that's what I think this committee has pursued. And I would put in record my thanks for Lord Gill for agreeing to our request that we have a register of recusals, which didn't happen before we raised this in April last year.
Welcome that myself, and thank you, Convener.
Ms. McCaskill, did you have a final one?
Good to meet with Gillian Thompson. It does seem to me she's come in both at having been at AIB and indeed at Senior Civil Service, whether she had a view as a fresh pair of eyes, whether that was known to you or whether that information could be provided.
Convener, if I may address that point, I'm not aware yet of Gillian Thompson's view of this, but I will be seeking Gillian Thompson's view on these matters, and happy to invite Gillian Thompson to relay her views on this issue in due course to the committee.
John Wilson.
On that note, Convener, the issue I'd like to put on record my thanks to Moy Ali and the evidence that she's given this committee in the past. I'd also like to congratulate her on her comprehensive annual report, which I know was submitted in August and was released last week. And it makes very interesting reading, and I hope the Minister, when he meets with the Lord President, raises some of the issues that have been raised by Moy Ali in her annual report, because clearly she has raised issues about the complaints procedure, the judicial complaints procedure, where she has almost alluded to when a complaint is made against a judge, it disappears into the ether. And there is no transparency in how those issues are dealt with. So it would be useful not only to take on board the new judicial complaints reviewers' view on how they see them taking forward the role of the judicial complaints reviewer, but also taking on board quite clearly the outgoing judicial complaints reviewers' experience over the last 3 years of having to deal with the judicial complaints process, and having in particular to deal with complaints that arose and the way that the complaints were dealt with by the Lord President. So hopefully we can move forward and we can get a system that everybody feels confident will take forward the best interests, not just of judges, but the public and everybody involved in the judicial process.
Thank you for that. I'm very conscious of time, Minister.
Just to Mr. Wilson.
Briefly.
Thank you, Convener. Just to say that I listened to what Mr. Wilson said, and I identify with what he said. I certainly add my own thanks, albeit I wasn't in post at the time. Moy Ali was positioned. I certainly very much welcome the report, and we will take forward the points that have been raised in the report with Lord President, and indeed to Gillian Thompson as the new GCR. If I could just add that we only formally received the report on the 23rd of October, so the gap is not quite as big as perhaps had been implied.
I would certainly want to back up John Wilson's point. Moy Ali gave excellent and no-holds-barred evidence to us, which is obviously very refreshing and very useful for us. And so I would like to back up the points that Mr. Wilson's made. Could I suggest to the committee that we consider this petition again in the new year, which time we can first of all reflect on today's evidence. We need to look in detail at the annual report of the previous JCR, and we look at the new rules and guidance, which I believe will be published by the Lord President early in the new year. John Wilson?
Yeah, I was going to agree that we look at this again in the new year, but could I suggest we tie into the timing of the release of the information from the Lord President in terms of his new rules, rather than us discussing it as a committee that only to find out the new rules haven't been published. So it would be useful if we could actually tie it in with the new rules being published.
Yeah, I think that's sensible. Kenny McCaskill?
Say that it might be useful to hear from the Minister in due course what they, either through him or directly from the new Judicial Complaints Reviewer, as to what her take in as a fresh pair of eyes.
Good point. Are committee members agreeable?
Yeah,
Well, can I thank the Minister and his two colleagues for coming along today. Thanks very much for your evidence. It's been very helpful in working out the committee's next steps, and I appreciate you coming along and giving up your time today. Thank all three of you very much indeed. I'll suspend for 2 minutes to allow our witnesses to change round. If I could restart our committee, we're in agenda item 4, consideration of new petitions. The next item business is consideration of two new petitions, and the committee will hear from the petitioner in each case. The first new petition is PE1539 by Anne Booth on housing associations to come under the Freedom of Information Scotland Act 2002. Members, my note by the clerk, the spice briefing and the petition. Could I welcome the petitioner, Anne Booth? You're very welcome for coming along. And she's accompanied today by Sean Clerkin. And you're also welcome, Mr. Clerkin, as well. Thank you for coming. Can I invite Ms. Booth to speak to the petition of around 5 minutes. I'll kick off with some questions, then ask my colleagues to ask further questions. Anne Booth.
Can I start off by saying that I have breathing problems, and maybe now and again I'll have to stop and Sean can fill in for me, because it just depends on how I go. My name is Anne Booth. A factored homeowner, and I am factored by GHA Limited, your place. The Freedom of Information Scotland Act 2002 was set up in the spirit of encouraging the people of Scotland to access information and to make organisations accountable. It is in this spirit that I am asking the Scottish Parliament to call on the Scottish Government to have this Act extended to all housing associations in Scotland so they are made transparent, open and accountable. Glasgow Housing Association, which in recent times has become far bigger in the form of the corporate John Wheatley Housing Group, is an example of a housing association that needs to be more accountable to its stakeholders, example, factored home owners and tenants. In 2010, it was clear that the GHA was the only housing association consulted on whether the above Act should be extended to housing associations. It is clear they did not favour this, and I believe for a number of reasons that GHA, along with other housing associations, have to come under the Freedom of Information Scotland Act 2002 through Section 5. Thousands of factored homeowners have had home improvement work carried out, which was composed of overcladding, re-roofing and putting up a community aerial, costing thousands of pounds. I could not get answers to such questions as, what did the quality assessment process consist of? What type of overcladding system was being used? What was the square metre cost of overcladding? And in addition, was the Housing Association charging additional money to factored homeowners? I also asked the question, was taxpayers' money being properly used or not? We asked these questions at various different meetings with the Housing Association, with them refusing to give us any details or any answers. It was only in 2009, after 3 years of probing, that we found out that the Housing Association was charging a 6% management fee and a 3% contingency charge. It took an expose by the Sunday Herald to force Glasgow Housing Association Limited to properly itemise all improvement bills to include the above information. I also found that my home, along with 80% of Glasgow homes, were overclad by the Alumas system, which should not be erected in damp climates, which it was. The point I am making is that thousands of factored homeowners would have been better informed in their decision-making had they been aware of all the facts and could have refused the work going ahead if they weren't happy with the cladding that was going on in their house. Therefore, if the Freedom of Information Scotland Act 2002 had covered housing associations, including GHA, this would have been a great benefit to stakeholders. 26,000 factored homeowners also pay a management fee, which is not itemised, and therefore we don't know what we are paying for. We don't know how they come to get this management fee, and we cannot get any financial breakdown of this whatsoever. That is another thing which we could find out if we had the freedom of information. I believe that all stakeholders would benefit from all housing associations coming under this Act, and that they would be more transparent, open and accountable. I believe that my human rights would not have been breached if the Act had covered GHA at an earlier date, as the work in my house wasn't to my satisfaction. I am bearing witness to you today and alluding to the suffering of others and stating that this could be avoided if all housing associations in Scotland come under the Freedom of Information Scotland Act 2002.
Thank you very much for your evidence and the very clear points you've made. Could I ask you about the Social Housing Charter, which, as you will know, places an obligation on housing associations to provide advice, guidance and information to tenants. Is that working?
No, it's not working. No. Anything that the housing associations that I know of set up, the people who sit on their committees are asked to sign a confidentiality agreement. So anybody that has to sign a confidentiality agreement, they are not then going to be open and transparent.
Because my understanding is that the Scottish Housing Regulator uses the outcomes from the Social Housing Charter to regulate and assess how well housing associations are doing. Is that aspect working? Mr. Clerkin?
Is that okay? The situation is, yes, you're right in saying that the Scottish Housing Regulator is very much involved in that aspect, but we're talking here about the provision of information to tenants and to factored homeowners. The bottom line is, we're in the new Scotland post-referendum, whether people voted yes or voted no, and more people are involved in Civic Scotland. So I think it would be very good if tenants and factored homeowners were more involved in the decision-making process through the Freedom of Information Act. It would improve decision-making, it would improve efficiency, and would basically make the housing associations more open and transparent. In fact, I can relate to the fact that Alan Benson, a senior member of the Housing Association Movement and Director of Milne Bank Housing Association in Glasgow, said community-based housing associations are already regulated organisations and are both obliged and want our activities to be open and transparent. Freedom of information obligations would not, in my view, present any difficulties whatsoever, quote unquote. And I think basically we would have better community controlled and tenant-led organisations if the tenants and the homeowners had the chance to access the information that they need to base their lives around, because that is their homes at the end of the day.
Without making judgments about FOIs, whether good, bad or indifferent, surely the current situation should ensure that tenants get good information from their housing associations, and if they don't, that the regulator should be picking this up and putting a black mark against the housing associations. That's the current system, is it not?
Well, not necessarily, because, for example, the fact is it was a chap called John Gibson who had to make a Freedom of Information request to Police Scotland, and basically to find out how much money was being spent on employing police officers by the Glasgow Housing Association was actually paying their wages, and he had to find out through Freedom of Information, and it was quite a large sum of money, and I think that would have been of interest to tenants and to factored homeowners and to other stakeholders that deal with the Glasgow Housing Association. The bottom line is, at the end of the day, openness is fundamental to the political health of a modern society, and I believe that housing associations have been subject to that freedom of information would make them better, more accessible, and basically basically more accountable to their stakeholders, and the stakeholders themselves would feel more involved and would be getting involved in the running of their associations, and they would find it beneficial and they would be more involved in the decision-making. The decision-making would overall be improved.
Thank you for that. Kenny McCaskill, then Angus McDonald.
I can see arguments and advantages, but can you see any disadvantages or arguments against? I'm thinking in particular of how freedom of information could be abused, perhaps relating to the housing of offenders, antisocial behaviour, or indeed other rights that people may have. So do you see any downsides as well as the upsides? And how do we then manage and protect individuals from what might be the abuse, if I could call it, of freedom of information?
In fact, since 2002 in Scotland, we've got the local government, we've got the National Health Service, we've got the police, and all manner of organisations that have been subject to the Freedom of Information Act, and it's worked well since 2002 as an act brought in by Lord Wallace. And the bottom line is it has worked very well, and it's basically improved decision-making in the public sector because stakeholders are more involved. So since 2002, we've got nearly 12 years now of experience of dealing with freedom of information, and I think that it's worked very well, and basically any problems like that can be worked out and can be reasonably dealt with. And I think given that we've had 12 years of it in Scotland dealing with very sensitive areas and with many aspects of the public sector subject to it, I don't see why housing associations cannot be benefited from that whole process. If it's good enough for the police and it's good enough for the National Health Service, housing associations should come under it just like any other public organisation.
Ms McDonald?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Convener, you actually make a fair point yourself about the housing regulator who should be required to pick up any issues regarding governance and expenditure issues with RSLs. However, I do have to admit that I have been at a loss to understand why registered social landlords have not been included in the FOI Act when opportunities have arisen since 2002 where a Section 5 order could have been made, especially when, as you've just said, especially when, for example, arm's length organisations are now subject to FOIs. I have examples in my own constituency where constituents have been frustrated that they couldn't obtain fairly basic information on governance issues of local RSLs, and up until recently, ALIOs as well. So I've actually got a great deal of sympathy with the petition. I take it that the petition, that's the main driver for the petition. However, I note that there is the possibility of another Section 5 order, possibly in spring 2015. So presumably, if the government commit to considering RSLs as part of that Section 5, that would give you some comfort.
Well, draw on the fact that Nicola Sturgeon, our new First Minister, stated, quote, "We will also want to hear wider stakeholder views in order to inform proposals relating to other bodies with a view to extending coverage further in the future," just as you're indicating. So this is in the spirit of that. That's why we're here today. And it's just so that you also know that housing associations themselves are subject at the current time to amalgamations and mergers. The John Wheatley Housing Group, of which the GHA is the principal part of, has now got over 71,000 properties. We've also got Sanctuary Housing Association, housing based in Dundee and housing based in Glasgow. And with these larger organisations, it is incumbent that they should be subject to basically more control and more democratic accountability.
Okay. Can I bring Angus McDonald back? I mean, there's probably quite a strong argument for GHA, and obviously what you described with that number of stock. As you know, some housing associations, particularly in rural areas, are very small. They are effectively private sector organisations or third sector organisations. They're not technically public sector, but that's by the by. Would you see in your proposals a sort of de minimis level, in other words, beyond a certain scale, that organisations won't be allowed to comply or asked to comply with FOI?
I think that all housing associations should comply. The argument that it could lead to, letters being asked and increasing their costs, I think that's a spurious argument. I think with the improvement in decision making, there'd be cost efficiencies made. I think that you're going to have a leaner, fitter, better housing association sector if their stakeholders are actually involved in questioning the decisions that have been made. It'll lead to better quality of decision making, because at the current time, whether you like it or not, a lot of tenants who serve on housing associations basically are ruled by confidentiality clauses where they are not allowed to talk to fellow tenants about what's happening in the association.
Wilson.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. It's just to take further the issue about housing associations. I'm taking it you're using the term housing association in its general term, rather than, because I think has been raised by the convener, that in the registered social landlord sector, we have many smaller housing cooperatives, fully mutual housing cooperatives, where some of the size of those organisations can be as low as 500, and in some cases even smaller. Now, one of the arguments against introducing FOI regulation to some of the housing association movement, I'm not saying GHA would be covered by this, but in some of the housing association movement, is the cost of establishing a freedom of information officer that would deal with issues. So is the petition intended to include all registered social landlords, not just housing associations, because the terminology has to be clear in terms of what we're dealing with. Because, as I said, if I was sitting in a management committee, a housing co-op, I might turn around and say, well, we're not covered because we're not a housing association.
It was housing associations that we were hoping would be brought under the information, as we also thought it would be beneficial, I think, because then we could then help to make decisions and work for the associations and try to come together about different decision makings, as long as we know exactly where we stand with them. At the present moment, we can't ask any questions at all because we get no answers whatsoever, none.
I think it goes back to the early point made by the convener, though, in terms of another member's round the table, is the issue about particularly Glasgow Housing Association in relation to its consultation and engagement with not only its tenants but the factored house owners within the Glasgow is more of a concern than, because I'm not sure by arguing for an FOI compliance with housing associations that you may get information after the fact. You may not get you might not be able to get information prior to, you gave a couple of examples about the cladding that took place. It wasn't the right cladding for the right climate for the right houses. But surely an FOI request would give you that information after they had done the cladding rather than prior to the process. And it's more about getting the housing regulator to ensure that there's adequate consultation and engagement with the residents and tenants before they go ahead with the work.
Can I just say to that one that by having more stakeholders involved in the actual decision making, the fact is it may come after the horse has bolted, as it were. The fact of the matter is that if any bad decisions have been made and through the scrutiny of the housing association through freedom of information, that's identified, then that can only improve the decision-making that will come thereafter. Because if any bad decisions have been made, that will be identified via freedom of information. And I think the freedom of information is a very good vehicle for basically improving the decision-making process then and in the future. Because if senior housing association professionals know that they're going to be scrutinised more closely, even more closely than they currently are, then the decision-making processes will improve. And because there'll be cognizance that they will be getting scrutinised by their stakeholders. And I think that can only be good for the housing association, because it means that the stakeholders are getting involved in the whole decision-making process. It involves that, as Anne says, it brings that cooperation, it brings that improved decision-making process together.
Convener, I thank Mr. Clerkin for that response, but what I'm trying to get is to a stage whereby the stakeholders, as you've described them, and our tenants and residents who are living in these areas, surely it would be better to actually get the consultation process right rather than using an FOI process, as you seem to be implying, that becomes a big stick to officers to say, well, if they get it wrong, we're going to actually do an FOI request, rather than saying to housing officers and boards they should actually be fully engaging with tenants and residents to ensure that what they put in place in the first instance is correct, not to then have a follow-up process whereby the threat is, if you get this wrong, we're going to do an FOI request.
Well, what I would say to that is that the consultation, as we've seen, can work, but it can also fall down very dramatically in local government, for example. Consultations over cuts to public services, consultations that have been rushed through and harried through. I think the freedom of information process basically gives an added guard, an added check, an added support for the stakeholder, and I think consultation along with freedom of information would go a long way, because sometimes in Scotland, in our history, consultation has become a dirty word. Sometimes consultation doesn't consist of very much. Closure of schools, various different things in the past, it hasn't had a great history. So I think freedom of information is a needed safeguard for stakeholders.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Would another member like to ask further questions? Thank you. We're obviously now at the stage, as you'll be familiar with for previous petitions, where we're now looking at the next step. Clearly, my view is that obviously we need to write to the Scottish Government about this particular petition. The Scottish Federation of Housing Associations are obviously a key body as well, and the Scottish Housing Regulator, an organisation I mentioned. I also think it's important to write to the Scottish Information Commissioner, the Campaign for Freedom of Information in Scotland, and perhaps a selection of registered social landlords. Can I ask members if they're happy with that course of action? Mr. Charles?
Convener, I'm happy with that, but can we have a look at some of the smaller housing associations who have very few staff?
Okay. And
Benson from Milne Bank. Milne Bank's an association of 2,000 homes. And also the Glasgow and West of Scotland Glasgow and West of Scotland Forum of Housing Associations are amongst the smaller of the housing associations, a whole big group of them. And they are smaller. They would very much welcome participation in this to be written to.
Thank you for that. John Wilson.
Thank you, Convener. And taking on board Mr. Clarkin's point about Glasgow and the West of Scotland Housing Associations, would be useful to involve them, because they represent a lot of the smaller housing associations and housing cooperatives. I could also suggest we write to Tenant Information Service, mm-hmm. Tenant Participation Advisory Service, Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, which I think you've already mentioned, Convener, the Chartered Institute of Housing, as a number of organisations that represent both tenants and landlords, to seek their views on this issue, because I think it's quite clear there will be differences of opinion in terms of how this would apply to different organisations, but it'd be useful to get that wide scoping to get the views of those organisations.
Yeah, I'm at target.
Just agree with what's been said.
Thank you for that. Angus McDowell.
Well, at the risk of being accused of being parochial, can I also add in Paragon Housing Association, which is a small housing association.
Okay, Kenny McCaskill.
No, I agree with the proposals.
Thank you very much. Well, as you can hear,
Scottish Tenants Organisation.
Yes, I think John Wilson mentioned that.
Scottish Tenants Organisation, Ian McInnes.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, can I thank you both for coming along and giving evidence to us today. As you can see, that we're taking this petition very seriously in writing to, I think it's the record number of organisations that we've ever written to. And once we've got that information back, clearly we'll let you know when this is scheduled to appear again. So can I thank you both for attending, and I'll suspend for 2 minutes to allow our witnesses to change round. Thank you. If I could restart our committee, the second new petition today is PE1537 by Shona Brash on behalf of the Coastal Regeneration Alliance on the proposed energy park at Cockenzie. Members have a note by the clerk, the spice briefing and the petition. Can I welcome the petitioners? That's Shona Brash. You're very welcome for coming along. And Gareth Bryan-Jones from the Coastal Regeneration Alliance to the meeting. And I could also welcome Ian Gray, who's a constituency member who's got an interest in the petition. Can I invite Ms Brash, if you could speak for a maximum of 5 minutes? And after that, I invite Ian Gray to make some comments, then we'll throw open to questions.
Thank you. Good morning, convener, ladies and gentlemen. I speak today on behalf of over 8,000 residents in the communities surrounding the Cockenzie site in East Lothian and beyond. Many other local people are of the view that this is a done deal, that there's no point signing a petition as the decision has already been taken. We do not share that view. Our communities are not against industry nor energy, but we believe there has to be a harmony between the two for both to be successful. Our communities have demonstrated this in the 50-plus years of Cockenzie Power Station existing in our midst. The Energy Park proposal arrived as a bolt from the blue in the local press on the 22nd of May this year. There was no warning nor consultation of a proposal of such a size and scale, too large for the proposed site, which would divide communities with strong historic links. In the weeks following, Scottish Enterprise organised a public consultation in the local areas, but could offer very little information on what would be included or how the site would impact on the communities closest to the boundary. People began to realise that the size and scale of the proposal would change their way of life forever. The loss of the green hills, loved open green space that is used by all ages for all activities, the loss of the site of the Battle of Press and Pans, a well-used network of pathways and historic wagonway. In fact, all of our well-used and much-loved designated countryside land was included in the Scottish Enterprise scoping proposal, bringing the greatest negative impact on our land and coastal environments and living memory. And we hadn't been consulted, nor had we known that our communities had been at risk for the previous 12 months without anyone telling us. Our quality of life, environment, wildlife and marine life are now all at risk. With greater disappointment was to follow with the realisation that our own council had been instrumental in suggesting the Cockenzie site for such a development, with little regard for the communities they serve. Over the past 10 to 15 years, the face of our communities has changed significantly. Many hundreds, if not thousands, of new houses have been built, bringing new people and new ideas to complement the talent that already existed. Previously, you would not have suggested our area as a hub for artists and out-of-the-box thinkers, but you would now. Our communities have changed, and with it, the aspirations and hopes of residents have changed too. While we will always honour our industrial past, the desire in our communities is to be part of the leisure, recreation and tourism that our county is well known for. Our communities can clearly demonstrate that they can embrace change and challenge. Positive community engagement came to the fore in the work of the Coastal Regeneration Forum set up in 2010. Residents put forward how they wished to see our community shaped in the future. The existing energy footprint was acknowledged, but it sat alongside a positive community vision, one complementing the other. The CRF final report was submitted to East Lothian Council, but does not seem to have been given any consideration. Two local fishing skippers with a combined time at sea of close on 100 years are of the view that the extent of dredging proposed to reclaim close to 12 hectares of the Forth will decimate fishing and change our coastline forever. Their view is the impact will be felt in many, if not all, fishing communities around the Forth and their associated services. Both Scottish Enterprise and East Lothian Council have relied on a statement in National Planning Framework 3 published in June 2014 to support the Energy Park proposals. This defines the Cockenzie site as an area of coordinated action, yet there is no explanation of what this means, nor is there any definition of what an energy park may be. The substantial change in use of the site between MPF2 and MPF3 was not part of the MIR consultation for MPF3 and appeared after the consultation process had closed. This gave no opportunity for anyone within the community to comment on the principle. If the Energy Park proposal is progressed, then we may have to look elsewhere, and that is likely to mean Europe, where we think a direct challenge to NPF3 and the Energy Park is likely to be considered under the Aarhus Convention. Convention. We are no experts. We are no more than local people living and, in many cases, working in our communities. The Energy Park proposal is an offence to the commitment and passion we feel for our areas. The greater offence is the feeling that no one is listening. There is no one to turn to for help other than to Parliament and to Government. We ask that Parliament urge Government to stop the work currently underway and to relieve the stress on our communities while proper and transparent consultation is carried out and consideration given to alternatives, including a positive community alternative which allows industry and community to sit side by side as it has done in our areas for over 50 years. Our communities want to be part of the leisure, recreation and tourism that the rest of the county enjoys. We want to celebrate John Muir, to cycle Route 76 to enjoy the East Lothian Golf Coast. We want our battle site preserved and enhanced, our green spaces and coastline protected, and our residents encouraged to enjoy our beautiful outdoors. Thank you.
Thank you very much for providing your evidence. Can I bring in Ian Gray?
Thank you very much, Convener, and I'm pleased to have the opportunity to speak this morning supporting this petition from the CRA, because it's absolutely clear that the local community I represent supports it too. The CRA have organised campaigns which have included public meetings attracting 700 and 800 local people. They have encouraged my constituents to write to me, and I have to say I've had more letters on this than any other subject or any other issue in my time as an MSP. Well over 1,000 constituents have been in contact with me about that. There is no doubt in my mind that the campaign is supported by local residents. The site that we are discussing is, I think, a strategic site nationally, the gateway to Edinburgh and to central Scotland, but we have to understand that it is a strategic site locally as well. It lies at the very heart of three communities, Preston Pans, Cockenzie and Port Seton, and their interests cannot be ignored. On the face of it, this is an industrial site that we are discussing, but the colleagues should understand that Scottish Power only use part of the site for the power station use, and the perimeter does include, as Shona referred to, green space such as the Green Hills. It also provides access to the local shoreline, is contiguous with and covers some of the historical site of the Battle of Preston Pans, and it is traversed by the John Muir Way, which was recently opened by the former First Minister. The fact is that the existing station at Cockenzie has served Scotland producing electricity for over 40 years, and Scottish Power have permission to replace the station with a gas-fired station, an idea which was broadly accepted, I think, by the community, not by everyone, on the basis that it would be a smaller facility. But there is no sign of that progressing. And Scottish Power would appear now to consider this site no more than a brownfield site, which they want to dispose in order to realise their asset. In this, I feel they are betraying the support the local community have given Scottish Power for over 40 years. They built that power station, the local community worked in that power station, and they lived next door to that power station, and they deserve some consideration of their interest as Scottish Power decide how to move on. The Scottish Government, having charged Scottish Enterprise with finding sites to create supply chain for offshore wind projects, led to Scottish Enterprise bringing forward the current proposal, a proposal, as Shona has said, not just for an energy park, but for the largest possible energy park facility that one could possibly imagine on the site. And local residents did indeed have no indication that this proposal was coming forward, felt and continue to feel completely excluded from the development of that proposal. It is a proposal which would massively increase the industrial footprint of the site, which involves 24/7 floodlight working, which would compromise the Preston Pans battle site, which would break the recently opened and highly popular John Muir Way. It would compromise a potential important local development at Blindwells, not far from the Scottish Power site, And perhaps above all, and the thing which my constituents have found most offensive, is the idea that it would divide these three communities and cut them off one from the other. As a proposal, it is unacceptable. It would also rule out other proposals and possibilities. I believe that my county needs jobs, but not at any price. And there are other ideas about how this site could be developed. Many see the tourism potential. The CRA themselves have developed a plan, which they've shared with you today. Not everyone has the same ideas, but in truth, nobody supports this proposal locally. This proposal has united the community in its determination to have a say. I think that is the most important thing. And that is why the CRA are right to appeal to the Scottish Government to ask them to stop now, to start again. I do think it's important that the site comes into public ownership, because there is a danger that Scottish Power will sell it to the highest bidder, and who knows what plans a private developer might have for the site. But if it comes into the private sector, then we must start again and work with the community, not against the community, to plan its use with local people rather than in spite of them.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Gray, for your contribution. Just before I ask the question to Shona Brash, just a general point I'd make is that, as you'll know, that this committee needs to look at the general principles of energy parks rather than one specific development. Clearly, I understand the interest you've got there, just because that's obviously the purpose of our committee. But could I ask you the question that Ian Gray raised, is that do you feel that this proposal will squeeze out other development opportunities?
Absolutely. I think our communities would like to put forward a positive community alternative. I think that could provide jobs which would complement everything that's good about Scotland and certainly good about our garden county. So I think there's room for everything on the site, as has been demonstrated over the past 50 years, to be honest.
Right. Thank you very much for that. Can I bring in Angus MacDonald?
Thanks, Convener. I actually noted that Ian Gray recently tabled a question to the Deputy First Minister on the Cockenzie Energy Park. And in his reply, John Swinney gave an assurance that a Scottish enterprise are not in ownership of the site. There's no site plan in their possession. And as the site... site plan in their possession as the site remains in the ownership of Scottish Power. However, he did give... Mr. Gray, an assurance that should Scottish Enterprise acquire the site, that there will be a full and active dialogue with the local community before any developments are considered or undertaken. So presumably that assurance gives you some comfort. Shaking your head.
To be honest, because I feel at the minute it seems like there's already been an awful lot of money and time and energy spent in taking the proposal to the level it's at just now. And the panic that I would have is that... how do you move back from spending such a lot of money? You know, if another year passes, I just feel anxious that it's going to be... It already feels to so many folk. We could have had 28,000 signatures to the petition, but folk truly believe it's a done deal. There's no any point. There's ships sitting out in the Forth. They're doing this, that and the other. It's already happening. And we're trying to say to people it's not. There's a process and people do listen. You'll be part of it, but they don't believe that.
Mr. Gray made some reference... ownership been taken over by Scottish Enterprise. Now, in our briefings, we don't have any information on that. Is that something that has been mooted?
No, I believe that Scottish Power still own the site. I don't think Scottish Enterprise own the site. I believe it's still in ownership of Scottish Power. I have to say there's been a harmonious relationship between the communities and Scottish Power over the 50 years. All our local bairns would go to Christmas parties in the power station. They worked really, really hard to develop strong links between the communities. The ground which... the whole site might be seen as being an industrial site, but it's not. The power station is on a very, very small footprint on it. The coal plant's on a very small footprint, and the rest of it was given over to the communities by Scottish Power, and we've enjoyed it. And, you know, it maybe is near land and we don't own it, but we feel like we do because we've had it for so long and we've done so much with it over so many years.
OK, when you speak about the footprint, you should presumably... This is it here, yeah?
It's bigger. That's the Green Hills on the front, but it extends all the way up to the Meadowmill roundabout.
Okay. Okay, thanks. You also mentioned in your introductory remarks the possibility of a legal challenge in Europe to NPF3. I mean, presumably that's a last resort.
Yes, I don't think nobody would want to do that, but I think we've come to realise that this whole thing did come out of the blue. There wasn't any consultation with the public. It appeared at NPF3 completely from nowhere. It wasn't in NPF2 and it wasn't in the MIR for NPF3. It just appeared. It's not in the National Renewables Infrastructure Plan. Cockenzie's not identified as a site for an energy park. Where did it come from and why was nobody told about it? Until May this year, we all opened our local paper and what's going on? Nobody knew about it. And I think that is at the core of why we're so concerned, as well as, of course, the fact that this is a massive scale proposal. The fact that it just appeared, there was no consultation, and it would appear, having done a little bit of work, and obviously we've spent several months now poring over mountains of information on the background to this, it would appear that this is about as clear a case as it would be humanly possible to get under the Our House Convention for a lack of any transparency in the planning system or involvement of the community within a matter of environmental planning. And people are telling us that's what we would have to do if we didn't manage to get the proposal put on hold now.
Okay, thank you. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Just to say I have some sympathy with your petition. I represent an area which has Fife Energy Park in it. Redeveloped and regenerated a rundown area has created a lot of jobs within my area, high-skilled jobs and well-paid jobs, and regenerated the whole of that Leave Mouth area. And there's the potential to take it forward even further to a point that we are now compulsory purchasing additional land to make room for more industries to come in to Leave Mouth area. Could you not? There was a lot of consultation with Scottish Enterprise because we have the coastal path, Fife Coastal Path, 500,000 visitors a year. There was a lot of consultation with local groups from Scottish Enterprise and from the Fife Coastal Country Coastal Trust to protect all these areas around the energy park. Would it not be possible that dialogue could go ahead for what the local community want in the area to influence the plan that goes ahead?
Yeah, it would be great if there was. There just hasn't been. There's been a consultation from Scottish Enterprise that included four A1 boards presented in a community centre for a proposal that's the biggest thing that East Lothian has ever seen. It's the biggest proposal East Lothian has ever seen. And there seems to be a lack of any information being given out on the fact that this doesn't include the power station site, and I don't think there would be anything, well, there wouldn't be anything like the stushy about all of this if it was just the power station site, but it's not. It's a huge area. It includes the battlefield, press and pans, the green hills. These are public open space, they're green spaces, and it's also fundamentally in the middle of communities. It's not on the outskirts of something. It's not a previously industrial site, although it maybe was industrial in the 19th century. Some of it was, anyway. It's in the middle of communities, and there hasn't been any of that consultation. There may be scope to do it, but it would be nice if it came sooner rather than later. It hasn't appeared so far.
One other question, and it's to do with the major concerns, and one of them is, which affects my area as well, underground coal gasification and the plans to go ahead. And the energy park would probably be used for that. These licences are issued by Westminster, and if you had seen the vote last night at Westminster, where a motion was put forward to stop fracking and underground coal gasification underneath houses, it was defeated last night. So it would have no relevance to the energy park whether this went ahead or not.
That's a question.
One of your objections here is that it would facilitate underground coal gasification within the area. Whether Energy Park or that was not there, these companies who have the licences will still go ahead with underground coal gasification.
That's probably right. This is one of the things that we recognise, that the designation of an energy park, whatever that may be, could easily be used for coal gasification, and it seems like one of the things that hasn't been mentioned at all in connection with this site, although it's obviously eminently suitable for it. In fact, some of the proposers of the coal gasification use the Firth of Forth with the north and the south sides, Methil across to presumably Cockenzie, on their plans. But there's been no discussion about it at all. Again, there's been no consultation. Most locals are completely oblivious to this. And some of the main, say, protagonists in this whole debate, Scottish Enterprise, Scottish Power as well, to a point, East Lothian Council, laugh when you mention coal gasification. It's never going to happen here. But
thank you. Thank you. Any other colleagues wish to answer questions or points? Can I just a sort of final question? Clearly, you would not want normally to go to Europe under the Airhouse Convention because that's a very lengthy process and presumably an expensive one. But have you done any explanation around that particular issue? Have any experience, anybody in your group had any experience going to Europe under this?
We don't. We're just a bunch of local people. We're not a bunch of battle geeks or busybodies. We're just local people who are really worried about what's happening in the middle of our towns. We haven't. We've had some advice from a QC who's been sympathetic to us, and we would have to take it forward with him, obviously, at the expense that would involve. And obviously, we don't want to do that. We don't have the money to do that. But I think we would do it if we had to. We don't want to let 8,000 people down.
We do hope that the group we're sitting in front of today and our own parliament and our own government will listen to the folk that are living in an area. The Energy Park proposal will slice up the middle of communities. The catchment area for a local high school is Preston Pans, Cockenzie and Port Seton, Long Nidry. Our bairns walk the pathways, use the roadway, all these things would go. And I know that, you know, Methil have found ways to get round it. We have been able to demonstrate that industry, energy and communities can sit together. And we would like the proposals as they stand to halt and to start looking at something that can work together to complement. Nobody's saying no to jobs. Nobody's saying no to anything. It's just let's work together for a sensible outcome.
Well, thank you very much for your evidence. If you just hold on for a minute, the next step is that we are going to look at the next stage for the committee. I think you have both given very clear and straightforward evidence, as has Ian Gray, on this issue. Clearly, it would be sensible to write to the Scottish Government, Scottish Power, Scottish Enterprise and East Lothian Council about this particular issue to get communication back and obviously to discuss it when we've got the full information before us. But that's my suggestion to the committee. As always, the committee, we have a different view. Can I just ask whether the committee is agreeable that we consult these organisations? David Torrance?
I'm quite happy, convener, for him to consult, but can we also ask him how much consultation they've done with the local community and what input the local community has had into the final draft plans?
Thank you for that. John Wilson?
I'd agree with David Torrance, in particular when we're writing to the Scottish Government, who would want to focus in on NPF3. Because I'm quite concerned at the issues that have been raised today, this proposal seems to have landed in NPF3 at the latter stages rather than in the early stages of consultation in NPF3.
Our members of the group will have a different view, Kenny McCaskill.
It seems to me that it would be better to try and get parties to work together, because it seems to me, listening to Ian and listening to Shona, there's no preclusion to industrial development. I think it's recognised that the worst thing might be simply to go on the market to the pub's highest bidder, which might be even worse than anything, even at the worst extremes of what's here, and just simply seek some public engagement, because it does seem to me that there must be the opportunity, given the size of the footprint, to achieve some of the things that those clearly with a future view of Scotland's energy needs in the 21st century can be delivered, but equally ensuring what is public asset, public green space, can be retained, and trying to encourage them to come together and work constructively, as opposed to perhaps giving an edict and a diktat, much as it has doubtless been, you know, well researched. So I think simply the tone and the tenor might be important, that we're trying to reach an accord, and people are, because people might not necessarily be on opposite sides here, if you just sit down and chat.
Came from outer space and landed at Cockenzie, and everybody thought, help my Bob, what are we going to do about this? And we really are just local folk. We're no experts. We've never sat in a room like this before with people like yourselves, and it's overwhelming.
It's a case of, hello, Houston, we have a problem.
Yeah. Hi.
could I thank our interviewers and our witnesses for coming along today? I think this is obviously a huge issue, but as I said at the start, we're also looking at the wider issue. I think we've agreed to write to Scottish Government, Scottish Power, Scottish Enterprise and East Lothian, particularly looking at consultation and MP3. Is also a vital aspect of this. Can I thank you all for coming along and giving such clear evidence today, and that includes Ian Gray as well. And I'll suspend for 2 minutes to allow our new witnesses to go before us. Thank you. If we can resume our committee, we're on agenda item 5, consideration of current petitions. The next item of business is consideration of 3 current petitions. The first petition is PE1463, by Rowan Cleaver, on effective thyroid and adrenal testing, diagnosis and treatment. Members have a note by the clerk and a submission from the petitioner. And I welcome the petitioner here today. I also welcome Elaine Smith, she's a long-standing interest in the petition. And I met Elaine Smith and Lauren Cleaver and 2 of our clerking team last week to look in more detail about this. Elaine Smith, would you like to give us a brief summary of where we're at with the petition?
Thanks very much, Convener. Can I start by thanking the committee for the amount of work that you've done so far and also for your interest? You've been thorough, you've been interested, and you actually have understood the issues, which I have to say is more than can be said for some people in the medical profession, so I want to say that straight off. So you've done a power of work, but unfortunately I don't think we've had as yet better outcomes for patients or any money saved for the NHS. So that's where I'm starting from. You have Lorraine Cleaver's letter. I think that's useful in guiding you from what to request from SIGN. SIGN guidelines might be helpful, but I think there are still other areas, and they could take time, actually. We know that. It could take up to 2-3 years maybe for SIGN guidelines to emerge. And there's other areas, I think, that still need to be addressed. And I would propose that the committee should still keep taking an interest, because SIGN might have to liaise with you, since you're the people that are asking them to carry out this work. But also, you've not had any feedback yet from the Scottish Government's work on patient experiences. So if you don't mind bearing with me for a minute or two, could I just go over why I think you should keep this petition open? I suspect you might be considering closing it. So first of all, there's outstanding issues, Convener. We know that more research is required into this condition and what other options there are for patients. The lack of research into areas like T3, that prevents medical professionals from even prescribing medication that could improve the lives of their patients. And so I think what is needed is trials of T3, also trials of desiccated thyroid hormone, and included in that, patient experiences, so that we're listening to the patients and not just test results. I think that's really important. You know, as a committee, there's still only one sole supplier of T3 in the UK. That means they've got a monopoly. And actually, there are current issues again with the supply of T3. So it's raising its head again, according to my chemist last week. We also know that misdiagnosis from your work, you've heard that misdiagnosis has got an impact on the patient themselves and the NHS as a whole. Patients are often misdiagnosed with things like depression, ME, Addison's, the list goes on. And you can see that from your 50 patient stories that you've received. Lorraine Cleaver's letter to you today shows, actually, I have a quote from that. It says from the Royal College of Physicians, we recommend that those patients whose thyroid blood tests are within the reference ranges but who have continuing symptoms, whether on levothyroxine or not, should be further investigated for non-thyroid causes of the symptoms. And that's increasingly worrying because, as you know from my own experience, that's what happened to me. So over a period of years, the NHS spent thousands putting me on heart monitors, brain scans, hospital admissions, prescriptions for this, that and the other, and prescriptions for a low immune system, etc. So the cost to the public purse of that is huge. It leaves people on medication that they don't need and is not helping them. And then you've got the specific issue of ME, where basically people are economically inactive, they're living a half life or no life at all. And I think that that's another major issue the committee could take an interest in. There's also the fact that you have things like 82 medicines for type 2 diabetes, 47 for depression, 45 for acne, 16 for athlete's foot, and 1 for underactive thyroid, which is an immense condition, as you now know, from all the work you've done. So, as we know, people are then sourcing T3 and pig thyroid from abroad. They can do that under the Medicines Act 1968, but there's no regulation of what they're taking. There's no knowing what's in the medicines, and I don't think people should have to go to these lengths, but they're doing it because they're rising from the dead. Many doctors seem to not, you know, many doctors are concerned about the Royal College of Physicians' guidance, which really only helps people who convert normally. People who don't convert are a real problem, as you know. And I think it's fair to say that endocrinologists are scared to push the boat out and try other things. They've got worries over doing no harm, but actually, I think they're doing harm anyway by not putting people and trying them on other things that will bring them back to life. So the correct testing is out there, but it's not on the NHS a lot of the time, so people are paying money if they can afford it to get the correct testing and to get onto medicines, but others who can't afford it are just left basically languishing ill. So I think also there's the issue of telling patients they're borderline. That's a bit of a scandal, and people could be trying T4. And if you look at your own Health Improvement Scotland scoping report, which you got recently, I think that's very telling, where it says that the use of thyroid function tests is based on generally poor quality, non-peer-reviewed evidence. So even if a doctor tests, it's only the TSH, occasionally T4, but the evidence there is that even these tests are weak. Dr. John Midgley at a Thyroid UK conference in October said there have been long, sad and unsatisfactory developments in thyroid function testing, including up to the present day. He says a lot more. I'm happy to share his report with the committee. We know that it's estimated that there's about 15% of people that don't do well. We think it's higher, but that's what's admitted to. It could be medical negligence not to treat them properly. And even those who supposedly do well in T4, they're still obese. We've got a huge obesity problem. Their hair's thinning, they've got dry skin, they're tired, etc. It's also estimated that only 20% of people that are diagnosed are referred to endocrinologists. I think more people need to be referred. I know of several women recently who've had strokes, which actually could have been caused by their underactive thyroid, and they're not doing well. They're suffering from ME-like symptoms, but they're not even being referred by their GP to an endocrinologist, and that's just not right with complex condition like an underactive thyroid. So I think there's many issues, convener, thank you for bearing with me, but there's issues like the research, the testing, the medication, the supply of medication. I think signed guidelines wouldn't address all of these points at all. I mean, it would be helpful, but I still believe that an inquiry by your committee would be helpful and welcome, since there's so many areas to cover. You're still waiting on the patient experience feedback from the Scottish Government. I think you've also got a new public health minister, that it might be helpful if you passed all your information to her and maybe asked her to address the committee on it. I think you've done such a power of work on it that it's not time to stop. There are thousands of women specifically, who are desperate for help. It's specifically a women's issue. So another line you could take is to ask the Equal Opportunities Committee, from the discrimination on women issue, to look into this from that perspective and maybe report back to this committee. And basically the bottom line is, I think if you stop now, then pretty much wasted a lot of time over the years doing the work that you've done, which has been fantastic. But what needs to happen is to change the outcomes for women and save the NHS thousands of pounds. And I think your committee has the ability to be able to do that and to do further work.
Can I thank Elaine Smith again for a very comprehensive submission to us. Certainly from my own part, I don't think there's any suggestion of closing the petition. I have got a way forward for the committee. Before I do that, could I just ask whether there's any specific questions members want to raise before we go to summation? Again, I think it's been excellent the work that the petitioner, Elaine Smith, has done. What I would suggest we do is we write formally to sign forwarding the evidence that we've received, including the patient testimonies and the suggestion by the petitioner of specific areas of investigation. Signed should be invited to work with the petitioner to initiate the process for developing guidelines in the area of diagnosis and treatment of thyroid conditions and formulating the necessary questions. In the meantime, we certainly want to keep this petition open, see what we get back from sign, and obviously consider any other aspects that we can do longer term, but certainly wouldn't be wanting to close the petition at this stage. Could first of all get the committee's view on that suggestion? David Torrance?
I'm happy to agree with the recommendations.
John Wilson.
Commissioner, I'm happy to agree with the recommendation as you've read out. The issue for me would be that we write to the Scottish Government, as Elaine Smith has said, just to keep them updated and particularly the new minister, and keep them in the loop in relation to how we are dealing with this. Because I think it would be useful if there's some pressure brought to bear by the Scottish Government that sign take up the recommendations from the committee.
Right, thank you for that. Anne McTaggart.
Can I just thank Elaine Smith for the power of work that she's done, in particular on this issue. But also, there's a few of... Yes, I agree with what you've suggested. However, there is a few kind of outstanding matters as well that Elaine Smith has mentioned as well that wouldn't be covered with the sign, Kavina. Could we pick up on that as well? And also, one of my major concerns is that Elaine Smith mentioned again the supplier of the T3, we've been down this road before, Convener, and I never thought for one second we would be back here again so soon. Could we seek to resolve, to ask the Health Minister why this is happening?
We could put this in the same letter we're informing the Minister about the signed guidelines. Yeah, no. Angus McDonald?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. In addition to the supply of T3, what struck me throughout this whole saga, for want of a better term, is the failure to prescribe natural desiccated thyroid hormone. I don't see why that isn't happening. So I hope we can get some answers to that, and hopefully it will be prescribed in the future, because it's a bit of a it's a no-brainer to me. I mean, it looks like it's a solution to the problem.
Thank you for that. If we add that to the letter to Mr. Spell. Ken McCaskill, I appreciate your coming in cold to this one, but didn't know that.
It seems a sensible way forward.
Elaine Smith?
Thanks, Convener. Just on the issue of the desiccated thyroid hormone, I think part of it is that although endocrinologists know that it might help their patients, they're very keen not to do anything that nobody else is doing. And so they're a bit worried about that. So nobody, in fact, I had a quote here, a medical investigative journalist report was quoting, it was a lecturer in geriatric care, but it's the same principle, who told a conference, we like to stick with the standard of care because when, and I won't use the word, hits the fan, we all want to be able to say we were just doing what everyone else is doing, even if what everyone else is doing isn't very good. I think that's a problem.
Yeah. I don't want to extend this debate, but I mean, we may have raised this previous meetings. I mean, have NICE been asked for the view on prescribing around this?
I'm not sure about that. I will check that. But I think the problem is it can be prescribed, as you know, and you saw from your health scoping report that it can be prescribed as a specials. But when we ask our endocrinologists, they're not prepared to do it because they're concerned they'll be put before the GMC, as Dr. Skinner was for years, even though he was never... he was never found guilty of anything because he was helping his patients by prescribing it. And a lot of GPs that are prescribing it just aren't saying anything about it because they're scared, frankly. And so so the kind of overarching guideline of do no harm makes them worried about trying something like that in case they do harm. But by not trying it, they could be doing people... In fact, I would say they are doing harm.
Yeah, it might be something you can explore and get back to us on.
Thank you.
And can I thank Elaine Smith again for coming along. I think you've... heard the sort of, we're very keen on this petition and we're going to pursue it in the ways I've identified earlier as added by my colleagues around the table. And I can thank Louis Cleaver again in the gallery for coming along today. And I quickly move on to our next petition. Thank you very much for coming along. Mrs. Ramsey. Right. Okay. The next petition is PE1523 by Jess Smith on giving the Tinker's Heart of Argyll back to travelling people. Members have a note by the clerk and the submissions, including a recent letter received from a Mrs. Ramsey. Can I welcome Mike Russell, the constituency MSP, who's taken a great interest in this petition. Can I ask if Mr. Russell could make a brief opening statement to the committee?
Thank you very much indeed, and I'm sorry Jess isn't here, but she is otherwise engaged, but she's grateful for the interest that the committee has shown and the work that's been done. I have to say that she is also disappointed with the progress to date, as am I. I wonder if I might just quote from a letter I received last week. I'm not at liberty to say who I received it from, but it was somebody in the heritage sector. And it really gets the nub of what the problem is. The letter says, although no one knows the origins of Scottish travellers for sure, they've been part of Scotland's history and story for hundreds of years, playing an important role as armourers to the clans, as bringers of news and useful items to rural communities across Scotland, and today as the keepers of oral traditions that were once all of ours, but which have been largely lost in a world so dominated by technology. The story is an important one within the story of Scotland. As Historic Scotland aims to preserve historic sites that help to tell the story of the people who have lived in Scotland over the past 10,000 years, by leaving travellers out of this history, the story of Scotland cannot be complete, and an opportunity to recognise the contribution of this community is missed. It also adds to the cycle of discrimination, in which travellers are not visible within the telling of our history, and this vacuum allows negative attitudes to this community to flourish unchecked. And that really is at the heart of the response that we've seen from Historic Scotland, regrettably. I think that Historic Scotland have not grasped the importance of this issue. And if their procedures are such that they cannot properly recognise the only site associated with the travelling people across Scotland, then their procedures, frankly, need to change. I am disappointed also that I'm unaware that there's been any substantive response from the landowner. Am I correct in assuming that?
No.
There's been nothing at all?
Nothing.
Well, I'm extremely disappointed. Historic Scotland is a public body, and I suppose, therefore, it is bound to respond, even if it doesn't do so adequately. For the landowner to ignore this Parliament, just as she has ignored the petitioners, is, I think, disgraceful. In those circumstances, I think there's much unfinished business within this petition. There have been, I think, over 1,000 signatures to this petition. There has been an enormous amount of public interest generated. And I shall certainly continue to back Jess and those who work with her to make sure that this small, tiny spot of ground is given the proper recognition so that we can include the travelling people of Scotland as we tell our story and as we move forward as a nation.
Thank Mr. Russell very much for that submission. Could you perhaps guide the committee in terms of what would be useful to take this petition on to the next stage?
I think there are three things that would be helpful. One, I think, is a reminder to the landowner that whatever her view is, she is not above the democratically elected representatives of the Scottish people. The second one is to return to Historic Scotland and the Minister, perhaps to question the position they've taken on the intangible cultural heritage, to question the procedures that they're following in terms of scheduling monuments, and to seek from them a solution to the issue so that and there may be other solutions to scheduling, but a solution that achieves the end. And the end would be to have this site properly preserved, because it is not properly preserved. I drove past it this morning and in the grey, wet light of an Argyll dawn, and it has a metal container around it and nothing else. It needs proper signage, it needs proper parking, it needs drawn attention to. And I think thirdly, and I know Jess would welcome this, and it may not be possible for the whole committee, but as you, convener, as a Highlands and Islands MSP, were you to visit it, I'm sure that Jess would be there to welcome you to it, but also it would draw attention to the fact that this Parliament is determined to do something to recognise the heritage of the travelling people of Scotland.
Mm. Thank you for that. Just for the record, the clerk's advised me that the landlord did ring the clerks and did speak to them, and she knows she's been invited to write to the committee, but she's not done so yet. So I'm hopeful we will get written submission.
I shall suspend my criticism until we see the letter. But I do think that if the letter went as it did timorously the end of September, beginning of October, she must be, as they say, guy busy if she cannot reply by that time.
Right, thank you for that. John Wilson.
Thank you, and welcome Mr. Russell's contribution to this discussion, because I think it is a very important contribution in terms of the history of Scotland that we're talking about, in terms of the role of the travelling people and tinkers, and the tinker's heart plays within that. The issue for me, and it goes back to the issue about land ownership, because we have a very, what I thought was useful, submission from Councillor Robert McIntyre, who indicates in the third paragraph of his submission that in April 1969, there's a record of a decision made that the area of ground allocation shall cease to be a highway within the meaning and for the purpose of Section 42 of the Roads and Bridges Scotland Act 1878. Would it be possible, Convener, to get clarification whether that meant the land reverted back to the private landowner? Because if this is a public highway, then why the land then reverted back to a private landowner is beyond me, because it does raise issues, and Mr. Russell has raised the issue about not only the site of the heart, but the access route into the heart as well, was what, as Jess had indicated previously, was actually public access land. So there is an issue about the land ownership and how that land, and whether or not this individual landowner who now claims ownership of the land has title to that land, and it does raise issues. But there are a number of things, and I think Mike Russell's invitation to go and visit it, I think every committee member, if they get an opportunity, should take that opportunity to go and see, because it's not just this site that's under threat. There are a number of sites throughout Scotland, and clearly from the response from Historic Scotland, I took it from Historic Scotland's submission in the second last paragraph of the submission on the 3rd of November. It actually refers to the 1979 Act, and the scheduling does not provide any specific onus on an owner to care for or provide interpretation for a monument. Then clearly I would be hoping that this committee would write to Historic Scotland to ask whether or not there needs to be a change to the Act to ensure that we do get the appropriate protection, particularly when in the monument is within private land, because clearly Jess Stirling's comments about the landowner can do whatever they want with their land, and they have been doing whatever they wanted with the land up until recently when the fence was erected around the site. But it's about trying to ensure that monuments like this are protected, and that we actually see the value in protecting those sites. So I would suggest we write to Historic Scotland to ask if they are proposing to bring forward legislation that would actually amend the 79 Act to ensure that we do get appropriate protection for sites that are held within private hands. Sorry.
I think both of Mr. Wilson's suggestions are competent. The first one about roads, we would normally write back to Argyll & Bute and ask for a view from the Director of Legal to get a view on that. But I think that's a very good way forward. Can I ask other members for views? David Torrance? Are you happy with that?
I'm happy to go with the recommendations, Chair.
Amit Taggart?
I thank Mr. Russell for his presentation, but I'm wholly concerned at the Historic Scotland's reply. It worries me that this is Scotland's only site, and it appears to me that we're not taking it serious. Can we meet with Historic Scotland to discuss this further as a committee? And I would also like to take up the offer to go and see Tinker's Hat.
Certainly on the point of can we invite Historic Scotland to come before us in the new year, that's certainly competent. And if the committee are willing, we will invite them to appear before us and to take this forward. I'm sure we can invite Mr. Russell to come along as well. I'm sure that will make for a very interesting meeting. John Wilson?
If we are going to invite Historic Scotland, could we potentially invite the Cabinet Secretary as well at the same meeting, so that we actually have both sides, the Scottish Government representation and Historic Scotland, so that we are actually getting the Government and Historic Scotland speaking from the same page?
I think that's a very good idea. Angus MacDonald?
Yeah, happy to go with the recommendations so far.
Great. Kenny MacAskill?
Yeah, well, I think there's two issues there. I mean, first is the land ownership. Land ownership brings rights, but it also brings responsibilities, and it's therefore disappointing that the landowner hasn't taken the opportunity to write. And I think we should maybe pursue the issue, whether with Argyll Butte Council, about the issue relating to roads. But it does seem to me that land ownership remains, and those who have vested interests, whether through their statutory authority or their ownership of it, should do that bit more. Equal in the historical aspect, I think pushing Historic Scotland is appropriate. They may be a marginal community, but they are part of Scotland's history and tapestry, as Michael was saying, and therefore I think pushing on the land ownership and pushing on the historical aspect are both worth doing.
Great. So, so as you can hear, Ms Russell, we're obviously very enthusiastic about the petition. We're going to invite Historic Scotland and the Cabinet Secretary to appear before us. We're going to write to Gowland Butte and check out the legalities. We're going to put a gentle reminder to the owner to give us a written submission. And I think there was also the point of writing to Historic Scotland about trying to get the criteria correct, because currently it doesn't seem fit for purpose, was the general point. Are members happy with that? It's a comprehensive approach.
Developments. I should have mentioned my gratitude to our Gowland Butte Council, who did respond positively, and I'm grateful to them. But Historic Scotland, of course, is going into a new incarnation, and it may be that with new management it might have a more comprehensive view of what Scotland's heritage actually is. That would be great.
Right. Thank you very much. Can I thank Mike Russell for coming along today? Appreciate that. If I just move swiftly on to the final current petition, is PE1526 by Jack Fletcher on behalf of Sex Expression UK on making sex and relationship education Scotland statutory for all schools. Members of a note by the clerk, the spice briefing on sex and relationship education in other EU countries and submissions. Clearly, it looks to me like there's two main routes forward for us, but members may have other views. To refer the petition to education and culture, to consider whether the provision of sex and religion education in schools should be mandatory, or to close the petition under Rule 15.7 on the basis that the Scottish Government will shortly issue revised guidance that the petitioners are supportive of, that the Scottish Government has given a commitment to raise the profile of SRE, that Education Scotland will monitor and assess the implementation of the new guidance, and that those who gave views to the committee were supportive of sex and relationship education continuing to be non-mandatory. Can I take views from the committee on which of the two options, or indeed others, we wish to pursue? David Turns.
Convener, I'm quite happy to close the petition, seeing as the petitioner is a supportive of the Scottish Government's actions.
Are members agreeable to that course of action?
For Scottish schools, given the pressures that come, whether it's from business, whether it's for financial advice, whatever, I think the government's shown willing, and we should leave it to those charged.
Thank the committee for the view. So, just to summarise, we're closing the petition under Rule 15.7 for the reasons I gave earlier. Agenda item 6, tackling child sexual exploitation in Scotland. The final item of business today is consideration of the Scottish Government's National Action Plan on Child Sexual Exploitation. Members, a note by the clerk, a copy of the action plan, and for reference, a copy of the Scottish Government's initial response to the committee's report and to each of its recommendations. My overall view, as someone who was particularly interested in this, and I suppose my background in social work, was generally I would welcome the action plan. There is, I think, a number of issues I would highlight that I was particularly interested in. I think having refuges for young people risk of child sexual exploitation is really, really important. I think having specialist services available in every region, as we recommended, again, I think is crucially important. So, I would also recognise the work that the third sector in particular is carrying out. And finally, the risk of sexual harm orders. I think that the use of the orders need to be more comprehensive, and I understand this is a complicated area involving the police, the fiscal service and so on, and I know that we asked for a bit more work to be done on that. But nevertheless, my overall view was that I think the action plan did adopt most of our, if not all of our, 26 recommendations, and I would particularly like to place on record my thanks for Bernardo's, who have taken the time and trouble to raise the petition. I think the committee has gone the extra mile by doing this major inquiry, and I'd like to thank everyone who's involved in it. Having said all that, and I think we have now achieved our objectives, and for that reason, there may be merit in now closing the petition, unless obviously committee members have other views on next steps. Can I ask committee members their views?
I'm happy to go with your recommendations, Convener.
Is it all members?
Yeah.
Sarah, I think it's also a moving feast, post Rotherham, post Alexis J, that you're quite right to thank all those who have been involved. I think action is underway. Equally, it's going to evolve, but probably all that has been done or that can be done has been done so far, and it's now back to the agency's voluntary or statutory.
And finally, I should say that we will obviously draw to the attention of the Education and Cultural Committee the work that we've done in this area. Is that agreed by members? Could I formally close the meeting?